believe the children are our future. Teach them well and let them lead the way. Show them all the beauty they possess inside. Give them a sense of pride to make it easier. Let the children's laughter remind us how we used to be. Everybody searching for a hero. People need someone to look up to. I never found anyone who fulfilled my needs. A lonely place to be. And so I learned.
Bless you with love and peace, and welcome to the Making It Happen, Take Action broadcast with your mentor and host, Barbara Herard, co-host of A.W. Bush. And today, we are welcoming back our fourth Thursday co-host, Reverend Kevin Taylor.
Welcome back. Thank you so much.
From the Hartford Memorial Baptist Church. Yes. Dear Lord, we come to you today thanking you for so many blessings. Thanking you, yes, for the beautiful sunshine that we are blessed today. Dear Lord, help our youth as they try to wade in the water, try to be better, trying to make themselves part of you. In your name, amen.
Amen.
I'm going to recite several verses from the 121st Psalms of the Old Testament of the Book of Psalms. I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from which cometh my help. Mm-hmm. My help cometh from the Lord, which made the heaven and the earth. He would not suffer thy foot to be moved. He did keep it, he would not slumber. Behold, he did keep it, Israel shall not slumber nor sleep. The Lord is thy keeper. The Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand. The sun shall not bite thee by day, nor the moon by night. May God add a blessing to reading, spading, and speaking of his word.
Amen. Amen. Lord God, we give you thanks for this day, for this is indeed the day that you have made, and we have come to rejoice in it, O God. Lord, we thank you that you have allowed us to be here one more time, and Lord, you're allowing us to make a difference in this world. Father, we're asking that you send the Holy Spirit to be with each and every one of us, to inspire us, to give us wisdom, give us insight, give us direction,
please,
to be the witnesses for you, and, Lord, to be a blessing to humanity. Now, Lord, be the God who touches, who blesses, who heals and delivers, who makes a way out of no way. Move us, oh God, to the next level of giving, the next level of believing, and the next level of doing your word. This we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
How are you today? Two wonderful reverends. One on the left, one on the right.
Doing good.
Blessed to be here.
All of us. All of us, actually. And so many good things are happening, you know, around the city of Detroit. People are excited. Everybody seems to, you know, trying to do their part.
The city is on the way back.
Detroit, the Motor City, is on the way back.
Everybody.
And it's going to take everybody from the smallest child to the oldest adult, no matter, you know, what you can do, what you can give, you know, be responsible, whatever it is. And our 501c3, the Motor City after-school programs that we have been involved with and studied and preparing young people each and every day over at one at the Hubbard Library, invite you to bring your young people to get tutored.
Because
it's always about those grades.
That's right.
Right now.
That's right.
And as I tell my high school students, you know, when you send in that transcript to prepare to go to college, you're just a number.
That's right.
You know, they don't know who you are.
So true.
So you know, study that STEM program, the science, technology, engineering, and math.
That's right.
And your English, your reading, your writing, all of those things are a part. It's like a package.
But
deal.
They will know you by your credentials.
Oh, you better
know
who
you are.
That speaks for you.
That's true. And on that note, we'd like to still invite our young people, or actually, the way it's turning out, Reverend Bush and, you know, Reverend Kevin, our program down at Wayne State, the tutoring program, after-school program, sponsored by the Institute of Industrial Engineers in conjunction with Motor City After-School Program,
Amen.
BHRSC, Inc., every Tuesday and Thursday through October, and we're going to go right along with this semester through December.
That's
and
great.
Then we have a break and start back up in January.
Tell the time.
And the time is 6 to 8.
6 so p.m. to 8 p.m.
On the second floor in the Manufacturing Engineering Building, 4815 4th Street, Detroit, Michigan. Phone numbers at the university, 313-577-3821. And Ms. Bembe Odemase, is there to help you, and I'm always available. My name is Barbara Harard, Ms. Harard, 313-585-4645. And Ms. Evans, very, very wonderful person, the advisor down there, prepares light snacks, are provided, because the young people are usually hungry. They always hungry.
All right, yes. And can eat.
Yes.
And
can eat, right. So and we have some food for you.
Well, that's great. I think that's fantastic.
We need to note the location of that building. That's in the southeast corner of the intersection of Warren and the Lodge Freeway.
Right. It sounds complicated, but
now,
it really isn't.
And as parking, as you go east on Warren, just as you pass the overpass, cross over the overpass, on your right-hand side as you headed east, you'll see that building, and right next to the building, there's some parking, two portions of parking. And you park in one of those lots, and you walk up to the back building.
It's the green glass building. It's the newest building
right,
there.
The newest building. It's two-story, too. I think it's the tallest building in the back of the front building. So it's the second building behind the front. There's a building in front of it. And you go to the building in the back. It's a multi-story building, about three stories, I think, at least.
What's so wonderful about, you know, the program is our young people can, while they're in high school, network with young prospective engineers who are actually helping to teach the basic math.
Most of them are upperclassmen, Mr. Art.
Right. I said they'll be engineers.
Yes.
They'll be engineers when they graduate this year. And they are assisting with your children's basic math, algebra, geometry, calculus, chemistry, biology. Now, everybody's, of course, not going to be an engineer. We have some young people who want to go into medicine.
So true.
And we have some doctors aboard, you know, Dr. Montelus.
You might have some astronauts also.
Exactly, who is
going
to be helping young people get
scientists,
into,
all of that.
Get into
computer experts.
Whatever field that you want to go into, we're there to help you. So give us a call. Also, because we are involved with the Detroit Public Library, Sunday Family Fun Days, you can come on out. The main library is open on Sundays, the Redford Branch Library and the Wilder Branch Library. You can call the public libraries for more information.
Two libraries open on Sundays. How about that? And from noon to what time, Mr. Rock? Several hours.
They have to.
Two to 4 hours, I think. Maybe 4 p.m. or thereabouts.
Give a call up. But that's wonderful
for
families from the smallest to the largest take their babies too. Something I picked up in the library, and I wanted you to know about it because we have a baby in our family, little Francois, who loves to read at two. Books for babies. Children are made readers on the laps of their parents.
Okay.
So
right.
Starting from infancy on up, bring your little babies on up to college age and beyond. And adults, they have something for you to
enjoy. The kids are thirsting for knowledge.
They really are.
And the earlier you start, the better off.
And, it,
and the smarter they'll be. They'll be young geniuses
at a very early age. Michigan Flute Orchestra Concert, November 5th. That's going to be at the main library. So, like I said, and it's free. So you want to take advantage of all these opportunities at the Detroit Public Library.
That's great.
Now, we're going to let...
We want to talk about the singing preachers now while we're making an announcement.
Okay,
we have the Calvary Baptist Church that's located on 1000 Robert Bradley Drive at Lafayette there in Detroit, right, I guess, in front of the Martin Luther King Jr. High School. That's where the intersection, not too far away. And you're going to have some, yes, Reverend Foster, Pastor Foster is the pastor. And you're going to have some singing and praising preachers.
Okay.
You're going to have Pastor Robert Johnson, Patrick Johnson from Burnett Baptist. You're going to have Pastor Robert Smith from New Bethel Baptist. You're going to have D.D. Coleman from Russell Street Baptist.
Okay.
And you're
going to
have Pastor Roderick Edwards. I'm not sure, well, they have it there, but what church he's pastoring. And Pastor Robert, correction, Pastor Larry Robinson. All those pastors are going to be preaching over there on Sunday, November 12th, this year at 4 p.m. in the evening over there at Calvary Baptist Church. They are hoping you would come over there and join them and praise it. Come over there and praise and sing and enjoy that Sunday afternoon service over there with them.
That's awesome. Now, that's the church with the orange roof.
Okay. Oh, that's the unique roof.
Bright orange roof.
Yes. And Reverend Foster, as well as Reverend D.D. Coleman, actually came out of Hartford.
Yes, they came from Hartford
they
Church.
They really
yes,
did.
Indeed.
So we're really proud of, you know, what the Lord can do.
Absolutely. Reverend D.D. and I were ordained as deacons
Praise God.
In 1988.
Wow.
Yeah.
Glorifying.
That's great.
Pastor Roderick Edwards is pastor of Powerhouse Temple Church, and Pastor Larry Robinson is pastor of Greater St. Stephen's Church.
Uh-huh. Okay.
So we know where they're coming from, and they are dynamic pastors and preachers and singers.
All right, yes.
Now, that's wonderful. Have, you know, our Reverend Kevin Taylor here today, who is pastor of General Ministries at Hartford Memorial Baptist Church, Pastor Reverend Charles Gilchrist Adams, senior pastor, and presiding pastor Reverend Christian. And we love all of them immensely.
Yes.
Now, Reverend Kevin, bring us up to date on what's going on.
Hartford is really busy and has a lot of good things going on.
That's true.
This Saturday, this coming Saturday, which is October 28th, at 11:30 a.m., we are having what is called the Touch Luncheon. Touch is an acronym that stands for Torch of Uplift, Compassion, and Hope. And the title of this luncheon is Reach Out and Touch. And it's a cancer survivors luncheon.
Okay.
Those who have survived cancer, those who are dealing with cancer, are invited to come and receive encouragement and a good word. And the keynote speaker this year is Deacon David Johnson, who is the husband of the now late Reverend Dr. Wilma Johnson.
Okay.
And she died from cancer.
Yes, she did.
And he has agreed to be the speaker. And so he's coming to share and to talk with everyone.
Wonderful.
So that's going to be this Saturday, October 28th, in the Fellowship Hall at 11:30. Tickets are $15 for that.
Isn't he Deacon Johnson?
He is Deacon David Johnson, yes, of New Prospect Missionary Baptist Church.
Amen.
He's still there.
Yes.
He did not leave. He's still there and still serving.
And
on Sunday, the 29th, October the 29th, Hartford will host the 100th Centennial Choir Concert.
Praise God.
Hartford is celebrating 100 years of existence.
That's a long time.
By the grace of God. Amen.
Praise God.
In honor of this 100th year, we have the combined choirs of Hartford.
Praise God.
Who have come together to do a marvelous concert at 4 p.m., and it's free at 4 p.m., and who is directing is our former Minister of Music, Dr. Jimmy Abington, who was our Minister of Music from the 80s through the 90s. And he has now come back to direct the choirs for this event. And it's going to be a marvelous celebration. I'm singing
I must say. And, I was wondering if you're going to mix that.
One
of the main men.
The singing pastor
I am
preacher.
The first tenor, okay?
And you really
and
can,
I praise
and
God
can
for
sing
that.
And dance and all
that.
Those kind
I
of
sing, yeah. And I'm with the dance ministry. I'm the director of our Hartford Men's Liturgical Dance Ministry. And we do presentations throughout the year, especially for Men's Day in February, the fourth Sunday in February. But we have these two events coming up right quickly, very quickly. We're certainly going into November, where we are preparing once again to distribute baskets of food to those who are in need.
Yes.
They need to call or come by the church and sign up for a Thanksgiving basket. Sign up for a Thanksgiving basket. And you're going to have a turkey with all the fixings and everything with it. And that will be distributed the week before Thanksgiving.
Good.
The week before Thanksgiving. So you've got that. And then on Thanksgiving Day, of course, we are delivering meals once again, hot meals, to homebound and homeless. We actually drive to the viaducts and areas of the city and just hand food to the people who are homeless.
And they have everything. How many years have you been doing
We've
that?
We've been doing this now. This is our fifth year.
Okay.
In doing this.
A wonderful, and, wonderful
it's
ministry.
It's a marvelous blessing.
Yes, it is.
It really is. It really is. So we thank God for that. Now, on the 18th and 19th of November, we have a play that is in commemoration of our 100th year anniversary. And this play depicts the pastors of Hartford.
Okay.
It's all about the pastors of Hartford and
contributions
that they have made to Hartford Church. And that is called Sweet Tea. That's the name of the place, Sweet Tea. And it's going to be held at the Northwest Activity Center in their auditorium. And tickets are $25. And you can certainly get them at God's World, at Hartford Church, as well as the Northwest Activity Center. This is on November 18th and 19th at 4 p.m. in the auditorium of the Northwest Activity Center. Now, the director of this is well-renowned director T.J. Hemphill, who created the play Perilous Times.
Many plays.
Indeed. And he's directing, and the play was written by one of our former young adults of Hartford.
Really?
In conjunction with our scout leader.
That's
they've
wonderful.
Come together and they have written this
That's
marvelous
fantastic.
Play. So it's going to be fantastic. So come on
Brilliant
out.
People
come
at
on
work.
Out.
Come on
come
out.
Out.
There are plenty of things to see and to do that are positive and uplifting and encouraging.
And, you know, we're so delighted that T.J. Hemphill, the playwright, has stayed in our community throughout the years. I remember that play. I think it was Your Arms Too Short to Box with God years ago.
That
you know,
that
and
was
all
a long
of those.
Time ago. That was good.
Yes. It's fantastic. Yes.
And it is still good.
That's outstanding play. Well written.
And so come on out. You guys remember him, you know, from that play and many other plays.
Yes,
so, And the name again is
Sweet Tea.
All right.
Sweet Tea.
And the date?
The date is November 18th and 19th. There will be those two performances at 4 p.m. at the Northwest Activity Center.
And come on out, you know, to all of our activities at Hartford. Now, I think there's a ticket for the luncheon on Saturday.
The luncheon on Saturday. You can buy your ticket at the door or you certainly may come to the church on, well, you come today and tomorrow to the church office, and you can purchase a ticket. But if you can't get there today or tomorrow, come Saturday morning.
Yes.
And pay at the door.
Really? And, you know, I guess we need to mention the wonderful social justice conference.
Oh, yes, the conference we just had, yes.
Really?
Last Saturday.
It was wonderful.
It was very wonderful.
I sat in with the young people, you know, talking about social justice issues that they face in education.
Yes.
They even brought up the national anthem and how they felt about, you know, the players bending a knee, you know, and the national anthem. So it was very enlightening. And then on to the main guest speaker.
Oh, yes, the luncheon.
The luncheon was wonderful.
Angela Rye, the attorney Angela Rye from CNN.
Right, and she was a wonderful.
She was fantastic.
Wonderful and really awaken all of our energies to stay in the fight for freedom.
Ms. Erard and Reverend Pastor. People questioning whether the football players have the right, and they're questioning why they're doing it and whether it's appropriate. But when I look at what Kaepernick, the reason why he's doing it is that he's highlighting the fact that young black men are being killed. He feels, and many others feel, unjustly by law enforcement officers, and he wants that to change.
Right, and not.
And this has been happening many, many years, and it's, you question whether a badge had the right to be judge, jury, and executioner. I talk to my officers, I'm a chaplain with DPD, and I tell them the only way you can justify killing another man is your life is at risk. You just can't go around thinking because you have a badge you can kill another human being.
Yes.
You've got to have justification.
And you know,
and the thing is, very seldom, if ever, a law enforcement officer is convicted for execution or killing another human being. And that's any color. But you can count the times a white officer is convicted for killing a black male, a black man. And you wonder why.
Well, there are still, Reverend Bush and Reverend Kevin, as we all know, so many injustices.
Absolutely.
That we face as African Americans, people both male and female.
And we all human, Mr.
Day.
Wright. We do make mistakes,
and,
but at the same time, we are held by the same judge and jury.
So
and
we look at it as a 21st century protests, a silent protest. Our rights are to silently protest. He was not damaging anybody by doing that. And then we found out also he was suspended from playing, you know, this year.
Well,
and he's protesting that.
Not really suspended.
He was blacklisted.
He was blackballed, if you will.
Blackballed.
Or
cut.
Owners chose not to hire him, renew a contract for him. So
he's suing.
In many ways, one could be it could be thought that he is being punished for what he is doing.
He's expressing and exercising his right of freedom of speech and action.
So true.
And action.
And he has raised the consciousness of the people to actually look at the words that are in the national anthem.
Okay.
That are supposed to reflect this is freedom, the home of the brave and the free.
So true.
Those
are some words.
Says, but is it really?
But
or has it been? And he has raised the consciousness and brought to the forefront the understanding of all of the systemic racism that has been going on for centuries.
And even in that song itself, the young people were talking about the second verse and how it depicts slavery.
Yeah.
And that if we sing it, you know, we go along with those detrimental things.
You got to remember, Mr. Roy and Pastor, that many years ago, I know when I came along and I grew up down south in a country town, we sang the Star Spangled Banner, but we also sang the black national anthem, which is Lift Every Voice and Sing.
But you know, went to a black
well, but
school.
I went to Michigan State University have the same where they would not embrace the black national anthem. Mm-hmm. And as students, we did the Kaepernick thing then. That was in the 70s.
Right.
We protested.
Well,
We protested. And our president of the university at that time during my 4 years there was black.
Okay.
The one and only black president in Michigan State University history, Dr. Wharton, Clifton Wharton.
Okay.
And he sat down with us.
Okay.
And we talked. We talked because along with our protests, there were other things that were going on campus racially with students and professors who embraced this national anthem, and when we did protest, we were booed and everything else by all of the Caucasian students.
My protest was down south at Southern University, and we raised our right fist when we protest.
Well,
the Star Spangled Banner.
I was raised young.
The same way the two track players.
Oh,
that
yeah,
won
and they lost
the gold medal.
They lost their medals because of their
personal
protests.
At the Olympics
protests.
That time, they were protesting the treatment of black folks in America.
Okay, I was raised in New York, in a different environment. I did go to school with Caucasian people.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, in my elementary days, I do believe I was the token one. My parents were very involved with NAACP and stood up and worked, you know, with Dr. King in Long Island, New York. But still, you know, I didn't really understand why when I became a teenager that, you know, we were so involved with the NAACP.
You didn't understand?
No.
I lived it.
Well,
so there was a reason for standing and protesting.
Because people of color, even out in Long Island, were being persecuted.
I mean, for sure.
But there wasn't back then, I do remember, there were no housing really for blacks that integrated up to New York. And my family, my father instrumental in making that happen.
Okay.
Well,
and today there's housing, public housing, income housing, all types of housing for everybody, you know, as you live in that very affluent place.
We didn't have a lot of rights, you know, Mr. Roy. Back then in the 60s, we didn't go to integrated schools, and when we took a trip out of town, traveling across the nation, you weren't able to live in the hotels and motels because they were not integrated at that time.
We have a caller, and we have another guest. So.
You know, we had to live at the Lorraine Motel. I lived there in the 60s, in 1964, prior
Let's
to
take this caller.
The King and Abernathy living there when they were doing their protests. Mm-hmm. Caller, you're on the air. Welcome aboard. Make it happen. Take an action. Speak up. Are you there?
Hello.
Hey, how you doing?
All right,
Hi.
But you got to turn
how
your...
How you doing?
We good. How are you doing? Turn your radio down, TV.
Can you hear me?
Yes, but you got feedback.
Well, all I want to say, y'all speaking the truth, but the thing that gets me mad, when they talk about kicking and me and all that, because of police brutality... We need to be taking
throughout
this whole country when it comes to black on black crime. We need to take care of ourselves and stop killing each other for no reason.
Well, yes, we do need to stop killing one another. Thank you, caller. that's a problem. And we all need to work on that.
Oh, seriously.
I was just telling
black on black crime.
That
is,
with all the churches on every corner, every block, we shouldn't have no killing in none of these cities. But, and I said, somebody's not evangelizing. There's work to be done, much work to be done.
Well, he who hath an ear, let him hear what thus saith the Lord.
Amen.
Okay, that's what the Bible says. So everybody may hear, but is not taking action. And I've mentioned to my parishioners and to people I know, we all have lived so long, and we've all experienced miracles and wonders that God has done.
Amen.
To know that God is real and that God
really
is moving.
Yes,
and because
is.
We have personally witnessed or heard or and certainly have seen, what is the impact of that in our lives to for
Jesus.
Us to move us to a greater level of involvement?
And before we
but the thing,
switch to talk to our guests, we do have to mention voting because it's so very, very important.
Yes.
And we still have to fight to protect our voting rights. We all should know the power of the vote.
That's right.
In Detroit, you know, it's coming up soon, November the 7th. If you don't know the background of the people that are running for mayor or all of the other offices in the city, you still have time to go online, research that, and, you know, put the best person in there that's going to help Detroit.
That's going to
but we got to remember our leaders, the people we elect, and some of them don't look like us, but we choose them to lead us. When they take office, they don't always give us what we once had. Sometimes they take away what we have. An example is our present president is taking away, cutting back on our freedom, our EPA,
health benefits,
the Clean Air Act. He's just changing every department that he won't properly enforce the right of immigrants to come into this country, and he's trying to kick out the Mexicans who are guest workers and don't allow them, who many were born here, to stay here. So he's just not fair.
We should also understand that everyone who is our color is not our kind.
That's true. That's a good point.
Trying to do and work on behalf of African-American people. So it is important for us to read upon the candidates who are running for the office, get as much information about the candidate to understand exactly where they're coming from, and to use your spirit of discernment to decide to vote for this person
for
or not.
Person.
And
so true.
Vote for the right person, that the person that you feel is the right person who will speak on behalf of the people.
Many of the department secretaries are taking back what we once had. An example, look at the Secretary of Education, DeVos. She's want to add more and more charter schools. Education is supposed to be a public thing, not a private thing or a corporate thing. And when you have less public, then you have more private control.
Yes.
And less public control. So let's keep everything public. An example, look at what happened to us here in the city of Detroit. We don't have as many neighborhood schools as we once had. They have to bus us, our children, to
most
schools
of
out of the city. Why is that? When the people living in suburbs can walk to their schools and our kids cannot walk to their schools. Is that fair? I question whether that's fair or not. Is it equitable? Heck no, it's not
and
equitable.
And then, you know, the quality of education is so important. And, you know, as I go around to schools during the week, in fact, I went to a school this past week, no books at all.
Still no books.
No books.
How many years are you going to have no books?
Computer education, which is fine.
But that's supposed to be extra, not
the basis.
Because, you know, they are preparing our students to get jobs, you know, for the future, mm-hmm. with Amazon, with Google, with whoever. So they do have to know the computer.
So they can't study but, in a book at home.
But if you can't read, you know, and if you can't do math,
yeah.
You know, you might not have a computer at home. And many right. of our
some
students,
can't afford to have one, to buy right, one, to pay really, the cost really. To be connected to the internet.
So, you know, I still really have a problem with that. I do see, you know, the computer, the technology part, it's got to be important.
That's right.
Because that's the way, you know, the children are going to get a job.
That's right.
They have to know the computer.
And then
but you have to know how to read and take this test also.
But they took the library out of all the schools. We used to have, every school had a library. Mm-hmm. You go to schools nowadays, there's no library.
No books.
In the schools.
And that's the importance of parental involvement in the educational concerns and needs of their children. It's important that the parents have a vested interest and take action in that interest to make sure that the children receive the best available.
It really is.
And it makes a difference if they will go to the PTA, if go to the PTA meetings and
be involved.
Go to the schools, be involved, and certainly go to the school board. And
demand.
Let them know that, hey, we don't like exactly what's going down here.
Really, because, you know, if you go out to the suburbs, those children have both. They
yes,
have
they
the libraries, the books, the technology,
yes.
the computer,
certified
everything.
Certified teachers.
And certified.
And they have a teacher assistant in the classroom. Right. There's two adults in that room.
So, you know, yes. that's what we want. You know, for yes. our young people here in the city of Detroit. And we cannot knock technology. We need that. But we
Certainly.
Need technology plus
yes.
Quality education.
That Detroit happens. Kids are being shortchanged. I don't care what everybody is saying. They are not being taught as fairly and as competently and thoroughly as our competition,
so,
our neighboring suburbs, as the children in the suburbs
and,
are.
And, you know, we have a new, you know, superintendent, Dr. Vietti, and we hope he's listening, you know, and
okay.
his wife.
Absolutely.
You know, they can change things, and with our help,
mm-hmm.
with everybody's help, the
mm-hmm.
parents' help, the community help, we're here to support.
We got to fight for our
we
kids.
We want the best for our youth. We're going to have
Absolutely.
To take a short break. We have another guest. Be right back with you.
I believe the children are our future. Teach them well and let them lead the way.
Bless you with love and peace, and welcome back to
Making It Happen, Taking Action.
Barbara Harright, Reverend A.W. Bush. And joining us is a very delightful professional young woman that we have today who happens to be a doctor.
Yes.
Dr. Millicent Traylor.
Medical doctor.
How are you today?
How you doing, Doc?
I'm good.
Speak
nice
right
to
up.
You.
I'm good. How are you?
Blessed to
great,
be
great, great. And you, of course, were recommended very highly, you know, by our dear friend, Dr. Moncrief.
Yes.
And
yes.
We just knew that she'd be sending us the best.
Yes, she's a lovely lady and one
yes.
of my mentors.
Okay.
Praise
awesome
God.
Position.
Wonderful. Now, tell us a little bit about yourself, and then I know you're going to speak about Women's Health Month and breast cancer.
Yes. Well, my name is Millicent Traylor.
Speak right up loud.
I'm sorry. My name is Millicent Traylor. Mm-hmm. I'm a resident physician at DMC,
okay.
Internal Medicine and Pediatrics.
Mm-hmm.
I've just been a physician for a short while,
okay.
but I grew up in the city of Detroit.
Praise God.
I went to Rufford High School.
Okay.
Really?
Really? I'm a product of HBCU, Prairie View A&M
Praise
University.
God.
Wonderful.
Yes.
Wonderful.
Yes.
It's member of the sweat.
See, it
yes.
can happen.
Yes.
Can
so,
happen.
And yeah, because yeah. I come from a single home, a single
okay.
parent home.
Okay.
Education was stressed in my home, and my mom stressed to me that you were going to go to college. Right. And since the age of eight, I wanted to be a physician. And praise so God. I pursued that dream to be a physician.
Congratulations.
Oh, yes, congratulations.
So it has been a long, rocky road, mm-hmm. but... Mm-hmm.
It's not easy, but
it's not.
As you know, I talk to young people every day. You can be whatever you want to be, mm-hmm. no matter what background you're coming from, if you are willing to do the hard work.
What is your specialty?
Internal medicine and pediatrics. Okay. So praise I see God. Adults and children.
Praise
okay.
God.
Okay. Yes. Now, talk a little bit about, cancer with women, with black women, white women, all ages or races, creeds, colors.
Okay, so this month is Breast Cancer Awareness okay. Month. So I have on my pink.
So she wants to breast cancer.
Yes. And that's important because 1 in 8 women will be diagnosed with breast cancer in their lifetime.
We need to note that men can also catch it too, don't we?
Yes, men can also get breast cancer,
which
but
is
it's
shocking.
More it is very shocking, but it is more common in women.
With women.
Yes.
Yes.
And so the good news is that in recent years, the incidence of breast cancer has decreased with early detection and hormone therapies.
Good.
So it's very important that you do get mammograms regularly so you can prevent breast cancer.
Yes.
Okay.
And in early detection, get early treatment.
Now, with the cutbacks with Obamacare, with all of those insurances that might, don't want to pay, what about African-American women, getting those type of tests? Is it going to be harder or what, what do they do?
Well, there are organizations like BCCP that will, is an insurance that's income-based that
okay.
will provide mammograms and pap smears to women between the ages of 40 and 65.
Okay.
So that's one resource.
Give that name again.
It's called BCCP. So BCCP.
Acronym for?
Breast cancer, colon, I'm sorry, I don't know the full acronym, but it is an organization that helps with the cost of insurance for people who are uninsured but still need these exams.
Wonderful, wonderful. Now, comparing to other races, do you find, there's more cancer in breast cancer in African American women versus other races, or how does that work?
I don't think it's a greater incidence.
Okay.
The issue is it's a more aggressive cancer in African American women. It's a little bit more aggressive, and mm-hmm. it may be lack of early detection.
Okay.
And by the time they find it,
okay.
probably
it
right.
is more.
More advanced
now.
Okay.
So yeah. So if we could get early detection, get our mammograms, and eat a healthy diet because that's
okay.
important
yes.
too.
Okay.
Yes. And
then
obesity in our community is large as well as in America. So it's a lot of things too that goes along with it. It's a healthy lifestyle.
Okay.
Early detection.
Okay.
Visiting your doctor regularly,
okay.
Doing home self breast exam to notice is this a change in the characteristic of your breast.
It relates also whether you have high insurance, because since many of us are low income,
mm-hmm.
many are unemployed,
mm-hmm.
then you don't have that
yeah.
great medical coverage that the people who are working do. So you might not get that frequent exam that they would get.
Well, if you have certain insurances like Medicare, Medicaid, with the Affordable Care Act, I know mm-hmm. Trump is trying to get rid of it, but it's
right.
still in effect now.
It is.
And with those, with the Affordable Care Act, there are certain things that have to be paid for by insurances, which includes screening exams for colon cancer, breast cancer, different things like that. So if you have a certain amount of people who are underinsured, but if
that's
you
right.
have
There's
Medicaid,
many of us don't have any insurance.
But if you have Medicaid, they will cover
some of us don't have that either.
Yeah, so that's why you I was giving that. The... I understand
We're
that.
We're talking about people who are poor.
Yeah, so that's why
you
I was giving the
rural
resource.
Areas, you go, you know, even the ghetto areas, if you will, mm-hmm. the urban America.
Mm-hmm.
You got people unemployed, not working anywhere, have no income.
Right.
Work sometimes, hardly eating.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have insurance. So,
right.
And that's the reason why they don't get identified yeah. with cancer
exactly.
until late on.
Exactly.
And it's too late many times for them.
Well, I think that's why Dr. Traylor, you know, brought out other insurances that they would fit into.
Yeah.
Yes, the BCCP. It also covers
yes,
men to get colon cancer screenings, prostate.
Thank God.
So those are kind of
that,
yeah.
Right,
so prostate. Those are some other type of cancers that are prevalent
yes,
African Americans as well.
And,
now,
and
what ages should men start getting that prostate exam?
Well, it usually it should be done with well around age 50, but anytime
they used to say 50, but you remember Kitty.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think her husband,
mm-hmm.
he caught it and died in his mid-40s, if you will, or close to it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So they say, hey, there's some exceptions. So
yes.
you might be too late. And when he caught it, it was advanced. So
right.
sometimes you need to start looking a little earlier than 50 if you
well,
can.
Well, so that's why you should go to the doctor regularly.
Relates to
so,
history.
Exactly.
Family history.
Family history is important. And just symptoms men may be having are important. And so if you have a relationship with your doctor and you go to the doctor frequently for checkups, some of those things can be addressed, so we can say, you know what, I think you need to be screened
and
for
that relates
prostate
to
cancer.
Any kind of cancer.
Yes.
You got to look at
now.
The history in that family.
Exactly. So that's important.
And if cancer exists in that family, then everyone should be keying in on checking for cancer, any
now,
form of cancer.
What about self-detection with women?
So self-detection, typically... You know, if you, a lot of women may do it in a shower or self
okay.
breast exam or lying down in bed, but you want to feel your breasts regularly so you can notice if there are any changes, any
mm-hmm.
lumps, and any discharge. And any woman that has discharge from their breast, that is abnormal.
That might be a little hard for a man. Is there a special technique a man should use if
I
he's
mean,
trying to
I mean, it's the same
go
thing.
Go to the doctor.
I'm just curious.
Okay.
Now.
It's kind of the know. Same thing. If you feel okay. a lump in your breast or something
yeah,
weird so. Or you're having some type of discharge from your nipple area, that's
wow.
irregular. So it's the same for women and men.
Typically, I know we laughed about that, but I know the men I know or knew in my life, they don't like to go to the doctor.
They don't.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So that's why I say
right.
if you keep
you're
a close
totally
relationship
right.
with your doctor and get regular checkups, some of these things can be addressed. So it doesn't, you know, if you haven't been to the doctor in years and you go and find out, oh, wow, I have cancer.
Yeah.
Maybe
mm-hmm.
if you had gone regularly
earlier.
And
yeah.
got earlier detection or talked about some of the things that were going on with you, your
yes.
body, then that could be prevented.
So I think it's a responsibility, you know, even of women, you know, if you have men in your life.
The sister, the mother, the wife.
Girlfriend, you know, significant other, you know,
yeah,
encourage,
yes.
you know, your gentleman to go to the doctor, or maybe you have to make an appointment, you know, however you can get
but
them there.
That's
your brother.
The same for the female also, the brother, the father, the
well,
the husband, the you know, significant other.
I don't know. I
need
I think
to remind
the
females to do it too.
Females,
also.
I don't really. See that as much as we'll go to
well,
the doctor.
But
I guess
because yeah,
sometimes
too.
Yeah, yeah.
You
because mean, sometimes we're so yeah, busy taking
that,
care
exactly.
of the family,
taking care of others,
the kids, others,
doing for others,
and we don't
look at you
take care of ourselves. Because
what about me?
I always tell you to slow down and get some rest.
Yeah, because
you
that was
well.
She
you call yourself
time.
Retired.
We do kind of overwork.
And you working
yeah.
all the time.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm a teacher who never stopped teaching.
Yeah, and then you would
yeah.
come home and you work in the house.
Exactly.
That's right.
Yeah. And I guess that's in my DNA because my mom worked. My mom worked until she was 96 years old,
mm-hmm.
and when she stopped, playing the organ. She told her pastor that, I just think somebody 96 ought to retire.
That's the message she gave to her pastor.
And then, but, you know, she did what she loved, and I'm doing what I love.
Right.
And I think that's important that, you know, if you do what you love to do, and, you know, no matter what it is, that, you know, contributing to society.
And within months after she quit, she went on home to glory.
And didn't want to go any nursing home.
The time was up here.
She didn't have to. So, Mother Terry.
Spirit told her when she should sit down.
Yeah. That's awesome.
So, anyway, we can have you back. You're very delightful, you know, young lady.
Thank you.
Dr. Trailer.
Yes.
Who's over at, you say, DMC?
DMC.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And is a pediatrician.
Doing great things over there.
Internal medicine.
Very good.
Wonderful. Thank you, Dr. Moncrief.
Keep up the good work.
Bringing us the best.
Thank you.
Praise God.
It's a pleasure.
God bless. And thank you, Reverend Kevin Taylor, General Ministries, Hartford Memorial Baptist Church, Pastor Adams.
Thank you, Ms. Erard, for doing so many good things for the Sisters of the Church for so many years.
Thank you.
And I see all of my students,
you know, running around the city, you know, and you come up to me in all different types of positions.
Yes, you do.
I'm in science, actually, and math. That's what I taught. And some of them are doctors, lawyers, politicians.
That's right.
You know,
they
whatever.
They remember her, though. Remember the teacher.
Yes.
Business people. Running big restaurants, hotels, you know, all around the city. And they got quality education. And that's how they're able to succeed today. And that's what we want our, you know, for their children and their grandchildren.
Teachers impact students' lives. They really do.
They do.
Just like preachers and pastors impact their congregants' lives. They congregate lives. It is what it is.
And that's really true, because I know Reverend Kevin Taylor impacted, you know, my son Francois's life. You know, Francois grew up in Hartford, and Reverend Kevin, you know, mentored him, and now he's trying to, you know, do what Reverend Kevin is doing, you know, be a professional educator and has his family and all that. So it does pay off, and we want to thank all of you for, you know, what you do each and every day,
Mr. Rod,
in the city of Detroit.
While we're thinking, people, we need to thank our viewing audiences for supporting us and listening in on us.
And thank always Mr. R.J. Watkins, wherever you are. How are you doing, Mr. R.J., Mr. Henry Tyler, Mr. Sean Watkins, R.J. Jr., the staff behind us, you know, in the office and all that. We love you. Thank you for what you do here, WHPR,
yes,
TV 33, Comcast 91. God bless. See you next week.